The days for the true Jesus has come. He's not an individual in one village calling himself Jesus. That person should be taken to the hospital so that they check his mental setup, because insanity begins that way. Insanity begins by claiming to be who you are not. Are you understanding me? This Jesus has no duplicate. This Jesus has no duplicate. He lives in you. Any Jesus that did not die on the cross parading themselves in the church in Kenya, we declare in the name of Jesus, let your power come to an end.
It's been said, if you want to get married, sow a seed. But God has sent Apostle Takim to tell us, if you want to get married, come into my manifest presence.
It's been said, if things are not okay with you, it's your foundation that is responsible, or some altars in your village. But God has sent his teaching prophet to tell us, if things are not okay with you, it is the foundation of the Lord that is missing in your life. The Cry of the Spirit Ministries in Nairobi presents the Prophetic and Apostolic Teaching Ministry of Richard E. S. Takim. Now, follow us to the sanctuary.
Jesus is so simple. It's so simple that he can heal you without fasting. That's how simple he is. He's so simple that he can deliver you without you praying and fasting. You don't need to go on dry fasting to be free from demons. Jesus is so simple that he can deliver you right there in your room without calling a pastor. That is how simple he is. But we make him complicated. And look at what our father said. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. He said, but I fearly somehow, as a serpent deceived it by its craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is of Christ. Verse 4, for if he who comes preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit which you have not received, or a different gospel which you have not accepted, you may well put up with it. Do you know why people are putting up with lying gospel, with another Jesus? Another Jesus will make you comfortable in your sin. So because he makes you comfortable in your evil ways, people are at peace with him. He feeds the gullible nature of people. But one thing you should understand is that if you look at the whole of this chapter, you realize people who bring another Jesus to the church are called false apostles. They are titled men, because the Bible says in verse 5, go down straight to verse 12, verse 13, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into what? Apostles of Christ. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Our father's warning us. He said, these people that bring another Jesus, these people that complicate the simplicity of Christ by giving you water, giving you oil, giving you all this stuff, they are false apostles. A genuine apostle will make the presence of Christ tangible in your life. He will not give you shadows. He will make the presence of Christ tangible in your life. False apostles will give you shadows. They will give instead of you receiving the anointing of the Holy Ghost, they will give you oil. Instead of you coming to the point of faith where out of your belly shall flow rivers of water, they will give you holy water. They will ask you to buy water. They ask you to buy salt, to pray with salt, instead of making you the salt of the earth. False apostles brings another Jesus to the church. And once another Jesus comes to the church, then your Jesus will no longer be enough. You begin to look for other things to add. You will not enjoy the beauty of the simplicity of Christ. And our fathers now said, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. Verse 14, everyone read it. And no wonder, for Satan himself transformed himself into an angel of light. So they can transform, they can metamorphose. They have the spirit of chameleon, the chameleon spirit. They come with the humility of Christ, but the spirit of the dragon. They look humble, they look quiet, but inside they are devils. They are master in copying, master in photocopying. In fact, we don't need photocopy machines if we have such guys on ground. They are more powerful than photocopy machines. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says in verse 15, therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also does what? Transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works. You see, the Bible said they can even transform themselves into ministers of righteousness. Can I tell you something? It doesn't matter the holiness I am preaching. It doesn't matter the holiness I am preaching. If I am behaving like a deity to you, I'm not of God. It doesn't matter the holiness I am preaching. If I'm giving you oil, I'm not of God. I'm giving you water and salt, I don't represent Christ. It doesn't matter the holiness I'm preaching. If I'm telling you that your star is lost, we have to go and look for it, I don't represent Christ. The Bible says they can counterfeit even the preaching of righteousness. And today, with the advent of social media, it's easy to steal messages from anyone. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So these are the catalysts that brings another Jesus to people and bring people to a point where they no longer have the sufficiency of Christ in their lives. Jesus in your heart is all you need. Jesus in your life is all you need. Any Jesus you have that is not solving all your problems is another Jesus that has been given to you. It's another Jesus. Now, you now begin to ask yourself, why do we have this kind of ministers? We'll bring in another Jesus, like our fathers have said. Who even transform themselves as ministers of righteousness, while they are not from the righteous one. Why? Let's consult the lamentation of the Almighty through the prophetic anointing of Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 13 verse 19. And when I say Ezekiel, please don't confuse me with your Kenya Ezekiel. I'm talking about the Ezekiel in the Bible. I wish the one in Kenya was like the one in the Bible. Ezekiel chapter 13. Before somebody says mentioning his name. Ezekiel chapter 13. Look at what the Bible says from verse 17. Likewise, son of man, set your face against the daughters of your people. Now, this was God confronting the false prophetic anointing that was working in certain women in the days of the Bible. He says, God, you see, can I tell you something? Our generation don't understand God. God cannot condone error. God does not condone falsehood. Whenever there's falsehood in the church, God will raise voices to cry against the falsehood. That is why we are the cry of the Spirit. And somebody is asking me, can the Spirit cry? The person don't understand simple English language. The word cry is God lifting up his voice like a trumpet and sounding an alarm to a generation that is being misled so that they will come back to the Lord. The Bible says that the glory of the Lord shall accompany such a cry, making the crooked places straight. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Isaiah chapter 40. So God will never allow error in his church to take root. Do you hear what I'm saying? God will never allow error in his church to take root. God will never allow false prophetic anointing to prosper for too long. He will always raise voices to stop it. Are you understanding me? To speak against it, to teach about it, to open the eyes of people so that they can recognize what is not of God. And we, the lines have fallen onto us in pleasant places. We are among those that the Lord have chosen on the face of the earth today. We are among. We are not the only one. We are among. And each time I look at the media, I see that many are rising. Even in Kenya, many are rising. We are going to shout against these things. We'll shout against this error. We'll shout against the deception until the true church of Jesus rise in Kenya. Say, yeah. Say with me, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Say again, your kingdom come. Your will be done in Kenya as it is in heaven. So shall it be in the name of Jesus. You may have your seat. And he began to prophesy against these women that were operating with the first prophetic anointing. And in this word that the Lord gave his servant, you begin to realize how the first prophetic anointing functioned. He says, set your face against the daughters of your people who prophesy out of their own heart. How will you know that the person is prophesying out of their own heart? Until the God who owns human hearts tell you. Until the God who owns the hearts of men. If you didn't open your eyes, you will keep believing. The person will take your land, take your car, take your certificate, take your wig, take your shoe, and everything. Once they realize that your wig is about 150,000, they will say, the Lord have said, if I wear it in today's service and prophesy, you will have a husband. And Mumu will give the woman your wig. And she will wear it and prophesy and return it back to you and transfer demons. Because only God can tell us what is in the heart of man. We can't know. And the Bible said they prophesy of their own heart. He now said, prophesy against them. And say, thus says the Lord God, woe to the women who sew magic charms on their sleeves, make veils for the heads of people of every height to do what? To hunt souls. These are hunters of the souls of men. I want you to understand that there are devils going about as preachers and prophetess who are going about hunting the souls of men. We are here to stop them, my friend. In the name of Jesus, either you like it or not, everybody must know his assignment in the body of Christ. My assignment is to identify the disease in the body and shoot it down. That's my job. Somebody said, face your own ministry. I am facing my ministry. I am facing my ministry. Let the thief face his own ministry by stealing. I am facing my own by confronting. I'm nullifying your stealing schemes. Everybody's in ministry, my friend. I'm facing my own. And the guy said, woe to the women who so much charm the slave, make veils for the house. But look, he said, will you haunt the souls of my people? And keep yourself alive. These people don't read this scripture. This is God lamenting. Will you lie to them just to collect their money? Look at verse 19. And will you profane me among my people for handfuls of belly and for piece of bread? Killing people who should not die. And keeping people alive who should not live. By your lying to my people who listen to lies. This is the lamentation of the Almighty concerning the church. Today, if you look at this scripture, there are two things that I want to bring to your attention. The reason why we have the false apostles, false prophets, and all the stuff is just they are looking for cheap gain. Just cheap gain. Do you know why the gain is cheap? You could use all your prophecies, have all the millions in the account. You could use all your deception, have all the cars, all the money and everything, but placing side by side eternal judgment, that is too cheap. It's too cheap. Don't sell your soul for money that you would die and leave behind. Don't sell your soul for money you would die. Nobody has ever died and they buried a house inside a coffin. Naked you came. Naked you are going back. So all these lies and stealing in the name of God, closing one eye to prophesy with what eye open, and you end up getting the money from the people, where will it lead you to? Remember, that life is like a vapor that appears and vanishes for a short period of time. That short period that God has given you, use it profitably. It's better to be poor and sleep on the street than to be a false prophet living in a mansion. I repeat, it's better to be poor and sleep on the street than to be a false prophet living in a mansion, coming with a convoy, having all the security on the face of the earth. It's better to be poor than to be a false prophet in affluence. Because the Bible says in the day of judgment, you are the first to be thrown into hell. And every soul that you have sent to hell, God will multiply the heat of hell over you. For the lies you told. Now you are doing it, you are happy. You have the government by your side, you have politicians by your side, you are just excited. Do not worry. The days are coming when the end of your life will come. You will cast gaze into eternity. You begin to ask yourself, have you run the race in time? You think that by closing your eyes and say, Father, forgive me for all the sin I've committed, it will be enough? No. You have to go and restitute. You have to go and return all the cars you stole, all the money you collected, and there will be no time to go and return. So you will be held bound. There will be no time. People think that when I stand before you and prophet lie and you give me money, in the door of repentance, I am to return it. It is called restitution. If I don't return that money, I still die. I would die and go to hell, a thief. You don't use, that's why I pity these people who are gathering people's money with false doctrines. It's like the false doctrine of raising altar. If I should tell you how much money raising altar have brought to a lot of preachers, both in Kenya and in Nigeria, I have privileged information of the money in the accounts. The ones in Nigeria operate in billions because of altar raising. The ones in Kenya receive money every month from fools who send 1 million, 10 million, 5 million to raise altar or sacrifice. Let me tell you, so all this money you are collecting, you have to return it back to make heaven. Prophet, apostle, you have to return it back. You think it's a joke? Jesus is enough. You are adding altar. Jesus is enough. You are adding sacrificial offering. Oh, you can I tell you something? One of our fathers called Samuel. He stood and told Israel, whose horse have I stolen? Whose person's silver have I collected? Another of our father called Paul, he stood and asked the church in Ephesus. He said, whose person's silver have I collected? Paul went to a place and chose to even work with his own hands. Even if he had the right to collect tithes and offering, he chose to work in his own hands. Because when you know eternal judgment, you behave properly in time. You can write it down. When you know eternal judgment, you will behave properly in time. It is when you are ignorant of eternal judgment, you live carelessly in time. You live carelessly in time when you don't know eternal judgment. And listen, the gain you are making is too cheap, my friend. What is money? What is land? What is car? You could have mansions. You can only sleep on one bed. No matter how big the bed is, you can only sleep in 3 inches space. Not even 3 inches, even too much. That spot, you at most, you roll this way, you roll the that way. You see, it doesn't increase your height. It doesn't increase your height at all. You could be flying around the world. You have all the diplomatic privileges. That does not increase your place in heaven. Life is too temporal to be wasted that way. That's why you see men. Paul said, I am not going to collect whose offering. Do you know why he was asking? So that he can return it back. You see all these men who are stealing the name of God. If they don't return all the money, they are not making heaven. That it is called restitution. Listen. Oh, where is it in the Bible? Oh, look at our brother who met Jesus. What's his name? The short man. Maybe he was shorter than me or what the same had, I don't know. And he climbed a tree to see Jesus. When he saw Jesus, without preaching, the presence of Jesus impacted his heart. Conviction entered him and he stood under the justice system of God. I said, everybody whose money I have stolen, I will return back fourfold. As soon as he made that statement, Jesus did not say, no, you don't need to do it. I am grace. I am grace. The grace of God is sufficient. You don't need to return the money. What did Jesus say? Salvation has come into this house. When salvation comes into the life of a charlatan, he will return the money they stole. When salvation comes to the life of a false prophet, they will return the money they steal. If they don't return all the money that they have stolen in the name of God, hell will be their home. That's why the Bible calls it cheap gain. And what did they do? He said, through their cheap gain, they kill those that should not be killed and spare those that should be killed. What's the meaning of that? Is God sanctioning killing? No. What he was simply saying, write this down. They entice the upright to ruin their lives and give false security to the wicked. That's the meaning of that statement. They enticed the upright to lose their lives, to ruin their lives. Do you know how many upright people have ruined their lives in these churches? People are looking for Jesus and they went there and they give them another Jesus. They entice the upright to ruin their lives and gave hell-bound false security to the wicked. Now listen, the Bible says in Acts chapter 4, quickly, let's go there. Acts chapter 4. Look at what the Bible says. Acts chapter 4, verse 11. Acts 4, 11. This is the stone which was rejected by you builder. This is one of our fathers talking here. Remember, we are consulting the voice of our fathers this morning. This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Everyone read verse 20. Nor is there, some of you are not reading. Sorry, verse 12, sorry. Read verse 12, everyone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we might be saved. Jesus is enough. What God gave you and I for our salvation is called Jesus. It's not just salvation from hell, but salvation from hellish circumstances. Salvation from the satanic and the demonic. Are you understanding me? Now, when the person of Christ was here on earth, he walked for 33 and a half years and left the earth and left behind the spirit of Christ. The person left and left behind his spirit. So right now, when we say Jesus is enough, somebody could say, where is he? No, he is spirit now. Are you understanding me? So when you have the spirit of the Lord in your life, it is enough. When you have the spirit of the Lord in your life, it is enough. Write this down. You will need the presence of Jesus in your life to get anything meaningful from God today. You will need the presence of Jesus in your life to get anything meaningful from God today. So the person of Jesus left the earth and he left behind his presence for us. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit is actually the outpouring of the presence of Jesus. The Holy Spirit does not have his own identity. Jesus is the identity of the Holy Spirit. That's why you see nobody have seen the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit doesn't have his own identity. Jesus is the identity of the Holy Spirit. In fact, Jesus said, when he come, he will speak of me. Jesus said, it is good for me, my person, to go. He said, when I go, I will send you another comforter or another of my kind. So he is sending his, he sent himself to us in multiplied form. So when we say Jesus is enough, we are saying the presence of the Spirit of the Lord in your life is enough. The presence of the Spirit of the Lord in your life, the presence of the Lord himself. Look at the promise that the Lord himself gave us when he left the earth. Matthew chapter 28 verse 18. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Hallelujah. That is why he is enough.